Thank you. Thank you.
The Lord our God is wonderful. All praises be to his name. We serve an awesome God. Well, how many believe that we serve an awesome God? Seriously, on a Wednesday night, who's just glad to be in the house? I'm excited. I'm glad to be here. Night two of this wonderful youth revival. Amen. Eastern Star Baptist Church. One of the best churches on this side of heaven. Oh, come on, y'all, give it up, please. To a very fine pastor, Pastor Kelly Andrews. God bless you. Thank you for having me. To Coach Jenkins for inviting me. Thank you again to these wonderful musicians, the choir, the awesome worship leader, all the leaders, auxiliary, just everybody, the ushers. It's good to see sound techs. It's good to see each and every last one of you. Just look at somebody and say, it's good to see you.
It's good to see you.
Won't be before you long tonight. If you have your Bibles, if you could turn them to Matthew, the 14th chapter. Do honor God tonight for my being here. It's through him, by him, for him, I live, move, and have my very own being.
Yes.
Thank God for my family here tonight, my aunt, uncle, mom, Ty, grandma, granddaddy, Miss Glass, my aunt Sonia, her daughter Shy, my aunt Bet. My aunt Bet used to hem all my clothes. Y'all need y'all clothes in, y'all call like that, all right? Should have them looking like that tailor. Matthew, the 14th chapter. If you find it, holler at me, say, I got it. That sounds like majority, so we'll move on. Matthew 14th chapter, beginning at verse 22. Very familiar passage of the Bible. And straightway, Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. When the evening was come, he was there alone. The ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit. And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. He said, meaning Jesus said, come. When Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Is that what you find in your Bible?
Yes.
Verse 29 says, and he said, come. He meaning Jesus. Jesus said, Peter, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus.
Yeah.
If you don't mind, those of you who are standing, as you take your seats, and if you're already sitting, if you could just look to your left or to your right, just say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
I'm coming out of the storm. That neighbor didn't like that. Apparently, they smell the aroma of your breath, your 8-to-5 breath. There's something about that 8-to-5 breath. To find you another neighbor, a neighbor that don't mind smiling at you, neighbor that don't mind telling you how pretty you look today. Shake their hand, grab their hand, squeeze, say, neighbor,
neighbor.
Oh, neighbor,
I'm
coming out of the storm. Coming out of the storm. Spirit of the living God, have your way. Move as only you know how to move, God. Decrease me so that you may increase. You get all the glory, the honor, and the praise. God, our prayer tonight is that we leave here a different way than we came. We ask that you change our situation. God, we ask that you help us understand how it is that we're able to come out of our current situations. God, after tonight, God, we pray that somebody leave changed. Pray that somebody leave delivered. Pray that someone leave set free. In the majestic, marvelous name of Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. If y'all don't mind helping me out, I know last night I sung an old song. I think I'm going to sing another old one again tonight. I know it's a youth revival. But this song is just fitting for the occasion, and the Lord had it on my heart ever since I got off work. So I'm going to sing a little bit of it. If y'all don't mind helping me out, is that all right? I'm so glad. Trouble don't last always. Can I get a witness that I'm so glad? Trouble don't last always. Let's say it one more time. Come on, put your hands together. I'm so glad. The trouble don't last. Over 300 people died from some type of storm in the year 2015. The last 10 years, over 700 people have died from some type of storm. Well, I hear you saying, why do we need to know about storms and people dying in storms, TJ? Why is it that we need to know that? I'm glad you asked, because we must know the severeness of storms, the fatality of them, in order to understand the importance of coming out of a storm. Storms are not designed to last forever. However, storms do come and they do go. But I stopped by Eastern Star tonight to let somebody know that regardless of the storm you're facing, we serve a God that's famous for bringing peace in the middle of each and every last one of your storms. And sometimes he even uses storms to strengthen our faith. There'll come a time in every individual's life where a storm or storms will indeed come. September 1999, Eastern North Carolina experienced a tremendous storm. Some of you may have been affected by that storm personally, and many of us had loved ones who had to experience that storm firsthand. But Hurricane Floyd came in and wiped out most of Eastern North Carolina, and it caused some serious damage. We couldn't control this storm. We could not calm the storm down, and we certainly couldn't turn this storm around. However, we serve a God that allowed us to be able to come out of the storm. The reason we're able to handle the storm is because the God we serve won't put more on us than we can bear. We have a witness tonight that can say, speak loudly and bold professedly, that God won't put more on you than you can bear. Just to give a background of the text, the disciples here, they just left Jesus performing a miracle. It's the first big miracle they've seen Jesus perform, where he fed over 5,000 people with two fish and five loaves of bread. The young people here tonight don't understand what a loaf is, or a loaf. You just think of it as five biscuits. He had five biscuits, two fish and five biscuits. So keep in mind, these are all women, men, and children. The men have been working all day. The women have been doing their womanly or womanly duties, if I must say, for lack of terminology. Kids are running around doing what kids do, hollering and screaming. You know how you guys do. So you can just imagine Jesus is now tired and exhausted. So he sends his disciples out on the water so they can go ahead to their next destination. When he sends his disciples off, Jesus goes along to prayer. Sometimes in life, we can face things and we can go through our day. We can work all day. We can come to revival at the church. And then it gets to a point where we just realize, you know what? Hey, I'm drained. I know Coach Jenkins told me today, he said, man, I haven't taken a nap all day. I usually get a nap in, but today I haven't taken a nap. That's because sometimes we just run out of energy. But Jesus shows us here. He shows us what to do. Jesus went up to a mountain by himself to pray. He didn't go home, Mom, to catch power, empire, and the latest have and the have-nots. But Jesus went alone to pray. I see some of you have been working all day. You've been diligently doing whatever it is you've been doing all day. After you leave tonight, if you want to get some strength, if you want to have some energy, I dare you to go home and just get alone if you can, just for a few moments, just so God can restore your strength while you pray. Got something to say right here, and I hope it doesn't affect anybody's religious beliefs. But every storm that we face is not a storm of the enemy. Some storms we face are storms that God strategically places in our lives or sends us through. Just because we call ourselves Christians doesn't mean we won't go through storms. Being a Christian doesn't keep us from being hurt. Being a Christian doesn't keep us from being sick. Being a Christian doesn't keep us from being depressed. Being a Christian doesn't keep us from being stressed. Being a Christian doesn't even keep us from being broke. Being a Christian, however, gives us hope, and it keeps our mind stayed in perfect peace even when we face the storms of life. We look at verse 22 of the text. The Bible says that Jesus sent them out in the water. So that lets us know that Jesus sent them to this storm. Tests and trials and temptations and tribulations, they do not come to kill us, church. However, they do come to build us. James 1, verses 2 through 4 says, to count it all joy when we fall into divers temptations, knowing that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work. Ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. In other words, a faith not tested can't be trusted. Look at a neighbor for the first time tonight and say, neighbor, can God trust you? Oh, come on, ask somebody else. Say, neighbor, can God trust you? I mean, when things are going bad, it's easy for us to call on God. When things are going bad, when we feel down, when we have a headache, when we hit low on our finances, it's easy for us to lift up our hands. It's easy for us to fall down on our knees. But what about when things are going good in your life? What about when you have a little money in your pocket? What about when your health is good? What about when you can walk and move on your lawn? Do you treat God the same when things are going good? Can God trust you? The first point, maybe tonight, we're going to come out of the storm. We're going to have to follow God's instructions. Verse 22, instructions are not for God's benefit. Instructions are not for our pastor's benefit, but instructions are for our own individual good. The Bible says to delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. It's an instruction. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him and God will direct your parents. It's an instruction. Honor thy mother and thy father so that your days will be long upon the earth. An instruction. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. That's an instruction. This is my favorite one, and I believe it'll heal our country regardless who wins the presidential election. But if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and heal the land. But it is an instruction. Most instructions we receive are instructions that will help us build our very near futures. God told them, he said, disciples, get in the boat and go to the other side. He gave them an instruction. Look at somebody and say, can you follow instructions? It was strange to me that the disciples said it was a spirit instead of saying it is Jesus. Surely they knew what Jesus looked like because they just left him on the shore. But Ephesians 5 talks about how light exposes darkness. And I believe the reason why the disciples were afraid was because of the light that exposed their darkness. Let me break it down for you. Think about how it is when you've been in a dark room for a while. You've been laying there, you just wake up, then the sun starts shining in the room, or someone comes in the room and turns on the light. It's almost too bright for your eyes to bear at that present moment. That's what happened to the disciples when they saw Jesus. Let's paint the picture. It's 4 in the morning. They just finished serving 5,000 hungry people. And these weren't just people. No, these were 5,000 people like you and me. They had our skin complexion. They had our attitudes. They had some of our nagging spirits. They had some of our personalities and demeanors when we get hungry. So I just want you to understand what it is Jesus was dealing with. Just think about him feeding you while you're hungry. So you can imagine, you can just imagine what they're dealing with. This was an all-day event because it says this was about the fourth night of the watch. So it was between 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. Just put yourself in their shoes. Think about what you would have done after a long day like that. Can we just be honest? Prayer probably wouldn't have been the first thing on your mind when you got home. First thing you would have done after a long day like that, I know we're all saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost, but after dealing with 5,000 hungry black folks, the first thing you would have done when you got home, or even when you got in your car, probably wouldn't be to pray. You may have said something, but it may not have been, "Lord, help." Which leads me to believe that something was going on in this boat that made them feel as if they'd seen a ghost. Think about back in the day, what you used to do after dark. Some of us didn't even have to wait until it got dark. But I know it was saved now. But just think back to your BC days and some of the things that you did after dark. I gotta say this right here to the young people. Just because you do it in the dark doesn't mean you're going to get away with it. Just because you do it in the dark doesn't mean no one sees you. You gotta be careful of who you hang around. You gotta be careful of why you hang around. You gotta be careful of where you hang around. You gotta be careful of when and who you hang around, and be careful of what you hang around. A lot of us are going through storms that we don't even have to go through. But because of our connectivity to the wrong crowd, we have to go through their storm. You can tell the company that you keep by the conversations that you have. In other words, a lot of the things you say them because of the people you hang around. If you do a lot of complaining, you must hang around a lot of people who complain. You do a lot of lying, you must hang around a lot of liars. You do a lot of cussing and fussing, you must hang around a lot of cussers and or fussers. Understand something, young people. You can be in this world without being of the world. And I'll break it down for you. The Bible says, "Be not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind." In other words, you can wear the Jordans, you can have the nice clothes, but have them because that's what you like to wear. Have it because you think it looks good on you. Don't do it because of what everyone else is doing, and please don't do it seeking the attention of other people. The Bible says we're all fearfully and wonderfully made by God, and when we start trying to be like somebody else, we are messing up the original creation. We are not being who and what God has designed us to be. I don't know about you, but I'd rather be an original creation than to be a cheap copy. You can go to the games, you can go to the movies, you can go to the park. That's what young people do. You can do this stuff, but when you see stuff going on that's not right, that's time for you to leave and to go back home. But that's time for you to let your light shine. We've got to activate that light that is within us. We can't let what goes on around us keep our light from shining or give us a dim light. But the thing I love about God is, in spite of what we're doing, in spite of how dark it is in our present situations, in spite of our fear, God still loves and hears our cry. The disciples on the boat, even in their fear, God still heard their cry, and immediately he comforted them and said, "Be of good courage. It is I. Be not afraid." Isn't it good to know that even when we can't see God, God can still see us? You ought to look at a neighbor for about the 30th time tonight and just say, "Neighbor, you got to let your light shine." So number one, we've got to follow instructions. Number two, we've got to let our light shine. Coming to my third point now, but verse 26 says that they were troubled. I hear some of you saying, "Well, since they were troubled, why didn't Jesus just stop the storm?" And I'm glad you asked. The reason Jesus went to comfort them and not stop the storm was because he had to fix the storm in their lives before he could fix the storm around them. So many times we want God to do this, we want God to do that. And God is saying, "Listen, I need to fix your inside first." Believe it was David. David said, "Create in me a clean heart. Create in me a pure heart, God, so that I may worship you. Cast me not away from your presence, Lord. Please don't take your presence away from me." In other words, David understood that he needed God to fix his inside before his outside changed. So here, You see, God, he says, okay, I need to fix the inside of them first. Let me get this inside fixed, and then I'll deal with the outside of you. If you're going to be able to serve me, if you're going to be able to be faithful to me, I need to get the inside of you fixed first, because there'll come another time when you're going to face another storm. He says, let me get the trouble of the inside of you fixed. Then you'll be able to handle the next storm. Even if I don't heal your body, even if I don't bring you out of debt, even if I don't bring your children home, even if I don't save your marriage or your relationship, even if I don't do it, I need you to have the type of faith like the three Hebrew boys. I need you to have the type of faith that says, even if you don't do it, God, I believe and I know that you're able. Many times we try to rush to our friend's rescue, or the moment someone calls you with an issue, we try to be their Superman or their Superwoman. We try to handle the issue for that person without letting God do a work in that person. But we've got to stop trying to be the answer for everybody's problem. Instead, we've got to give them Jesus. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Shout, somebody just shout out, we got to give them Jesus. Coming to a close now, but verse 28 brings in my boy Peter. Peter here, this is where he'll show the manifestation of him walking on the water. Peter, he was a bold and risky guy. He would do whatever he felt like doing in any present given moment, say whatever he felt like doing. I know some of you are looking at me, some of you even have that type of mentality sometimes. Regardless of who's in charge, you'll do what you want to do. Pastor, I know you don't have that problem here in Eastern Star, where people just want to tell you how to do it and tell you what to do with the vision that God has given you. I know you don't have to deal with it now, but Peter was just that type of guy where he said and did whatever it was he felt like doing. So if anybody on the boat was going to get out and see if it was Jesus, you can imagine that it would be Peter that would be the one to do it. So Peter activated my last point, which is he let go of fear and he grabbed hold of faith. Yes. Some of you, if you're going to come out of the storm, we've got to understand how to let go and let God. Yes. Allow God to work and fix our situation. If you don't mind, just nudge a neighbor and say, neighbor,
neighbor.
Now it's time for us to get out of the boat.
Yes.
We can't get complacent in the boat because God is always looking to do a miracle. 11 people stayed in the boat, but there was one who got out of the boat. Sometimes it only takes one person to get out of the boat to show others around you that God has got your back with every faith step that you take. Songwriter said, why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely when Jesus is my portion? A constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. You may not be able to see your way out of the storm. You may not even know when you're going to come out, but we can all be encouraged because we know who knows all about us. God knows all about us. He knows when we're sleeping. He knows when we are awake. He knows when we've been good or bad, so we've got to be good for goodness sake. God knows. Because he knows, you ought to shout before you come out of the storm. You ought to praise him in advance before you come out of your situation. Because when praises go up, blessings indeed do come down. If anybody here is in need of a blessing, and anybody here is in need of deliverance, anybody in need of a breakthrough, I dare you to give God a praise right now. Shout to heaven, give him a praise on credit for what he's doing. That was cute. That was real cute. But I said, if anybody is in need of anything from God, the God that says he'll supply every last one of our needs according to his riches and glory. Not our riches, but his riches. So if you need anything from God, I dare you to shout right now up to heaven in advance. That was better than believe God hears you. I feel a little better now. But I'm reminded of a story as I'm leaving. It's a story about a little boy named Johnny. Johnny was with his grandmother. His grandmother was cooking Sunday dinner, and grandmother said, "Johnny, look, I need you to stay here. Watch over this food as I run to the store. I forgot an important ingredient." Johnny looked at grandmother and said, "Don't worry, grandmother, I got it, it's okay. Everything's fine, grandmother, I got it." You know how you do young people in your little soft, sarcastic voices. So grandmother leaves. As soon as she hits the door, Johnny takes off running downstairs. Forgets all about what grandmother told him. So Johnny's downstairs, he's playing his Xbox One, his PlayStation 4, he's on Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, whatever it is that you have. In other words, Johnny is distracted. So Johnny's downstairs now, and a few minutes pass by, he begins to smell some smoke. And Johnny says, "Well, you know, I'm not that old, but I do understand when I smell smoke, something is wrong." So Johnny goes upstairs, and the closer he gets to the kitchen, he begins to see smoke. So now Johnny, you know, a young boy, he begins to panic. And he's not panicking because the house is smoking, but he's panicking because he knows grandma's gonna kill him if he makes it out of this smoke. So Johnny gets in the kitchen and it's full of smoke. By this time, he hears all the sirens outside. He can hear the fire trucks, hears the ambulance, first responders, they're outside. They're trying to get in, but the way grandmother has the house boarded up, no one can get in. The only way out is getting out from the inside out. So Johnny says, "I've got to figure out how I'm going to get out of this smoke. In other words, I got to figure out how I'm going to come out of my storm." So Johnny looks over on the counter and he sees an old cookbook. He grabs the cookbook, he says, "Okay, I'll stand on this and I know what to elevate me out of this smoke." So he stood on the cookbook and Johnny realized the book didn't elevate him high enough to get out of the smoke. Johnny looked over again, he saw an old math book, he grabbed the math book, placed it on top of the cookbook. He said, "Now I know I'll get out with two big books." He stood on both of the books and Johnny realized, he said, "I still can't make it out of this window." So then Johnny looks over again and he's beginning to get a little frustrated now, scratching his head. He's beginning to sweat. He's getting real tired now. You can imagine little Johnny, young boy, faced with a type of situation like this. So Johnny looks around. He says, "You know what? This is going to be my last time looking around." Johnny sees an old dusty book. He can't really make out what it is. He grabs it, wipes the dust off. And then Johnny realizes this is a book that grandmother taught him about growing up. This was a book whenever Johnny would get ready for bed, grandmother would read a few verses out of this book in order to put him to sleep. Grandmother would tell him some things in order to get them through life because it was just the two of them. So Johnny took this book and he placed it on the counter. Lo and behold, Johnny stood on this book. You should have saw the faces of the firefighters and the ambulance. They were amazed that he was able to stand on this one book and come out of the window. I bid you good evening, Eastern Star. But if we're going to come out of the storm, that's what we've got to learn how to do. In other words, we've got to learn how to stand on the word of God. That's what Peter did in the text. You can look at the text, verse 29, verse 28, brothers, and Peter said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water." Verse 29 said, Jesus said, "Come." I'll stop right there, because a lot of us think Peter was walking on the water. But Peter was really walking on the word of God. And if we're going to come out of our storm, we got to learn how to stand on God's word. When you're dealing with sickness in your body, you got to stand on being healed by his stripes. When your finances are a little low, you got to learn how to stand on God supplying every last one of our needs. When you feel like you can't make it through the day, or you can't pass your math test. You've got to stand on the word of God that says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. When you're dealing with hellish people on your job or all around you in the community, you've got to learn how to stand on God's word that says, God will make your enemies your footstool. Do I have a witness here tonight that knows any things about standing on the word of God? In other words, we've got to trust in the Lord with all of our hearts, leaning not to our own understanding, but in all of our ways, we've got to learn how to acknowledge the Lord. And God said, if we do that, if we will do our part, then He will direct our paths. I promise you, I'm leaving you, but we've got to learn how to get out of the boat. Some of you here tonight are in a boat of some of you here tonight are in a boat of poverty. Some of you tonight are in a boat of bad health. Some of you tonight are in a boat of bad finances. Some of you in a boat with a reprobated mind. Some of you in a boat dealing with all type of troubles. Some of you in a boat where you're dealing with relationship issues. Some of you in a boat where you're dealing with family issues. But I dare you tonight to pull on somebody and tell them it's time to get out of the boat. It's time to get out of the boat. The thing for this week is I have a dream. And it's good you can have a dream in the boat. But if you're going to activate that dream, you've got to learn how to step out of the boat. You've got to learn how to walk on God's word. As Christians, we walk by faith and not by sight. Is there anybody here that says, I will walk with the Lord as long as He holds my hand? Never have I seen the righteous forsaken, nor the seed begging bread. But I'm going to get out of the boat. I'm going to get out of the boat of laziness. I'm going to get out of the boat of being nothing. I'm going to get out of the boat of being a failure. I'm going to get out of the boat of homosexuality. I'm going to get out of the boat of being a drunk. I'm going to get out of the boat of being high all the time. I'm going to get out of the boat of the devil always attacking me. I'm going to get out of the boat of fornication. I'm going to get out of the boat of each and every last attack that the enemy tries to throw my way. I'm going to wait on the Lord to bring me out of the storm. If I'm going to come out of the storm, I've got to follow God's instructions. I've got to let my light shine. I've got to let go of fear, and I've got to grab hold of faith. Reason why I've got to let go of fear, because fear will lock up things that only faith can set free. The disciples here, they went contrary winds. In other words, the winds were against the boat. Bible says, it puzzled me, it said they were in contrary winds. I really didn't understand that, because winds are a part of a storm. So I couldn't understand why the Bible would say the wind was contrary. What the Bible was trying to show us was that in life, when we do things, when we're serving God, things are going to come up against us. There are going to be things that are contrary to everything that we try to do for God. Every time we take one step, the devil wants to knock us back too. We're going to face contrary winds. It's nothing against us. It's not that you're doing anything wrong, but that's just the way the enemy works. He comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. So as long as you're living for Jesus, young people, as long as you're trying to do the right thing, don't let anybody tell you that you shouldn't be doing the wrong thing. Don't let anyone talk you out of doing the right things. Don't let anybody tell you that what you're doing is too much. Don't let anybody tell you that being smart is not cool. Don't let anybody tell you that living for God is not a good thing to do. Because the truth of the matter is only what we do for Christ will indeed last. Look at somebody and say, I'm coming out of the storm.
Safe to say that we all will experience a storm at some point. As I was sitting there listening to you, Minister Walker, you know, when we have bad storms, we then label it as a state of emergency. I think when we look at some of the storms that our young people are fighting today, it's a state of emergency. It's a lot serious in what we communicate. You know, we water down, really, the troubles that are facing our young people, but we really are in a state of emergency for our young people. And so, I hope that after this invitation to discipleship, that any of our young people here, even young adults, will be propelled to come forward and maybe have someone pray with you or maybe even offer your life. But I want to say real fast, as far as an invitation to discipleship is, this morning I was thinking about what to say. And one thing that comes natural to me is I was a basketball coach for years, and I thought about the thing that I love so much about coaching basketball was there were four quarters. And so it really didn't always matter how you started, because there was always time to come back, and there was always time to make a run, and there was always time for another momentum shift. So I never worried if we came out too fast or if we came out too slow. And then I thought about the other part I loved about coaching basketball was there's two halves. So, you know, if you don't play a good half, then you come in the second half. And so my philosophy was, if you lose the first half, you better win the second half. But you know, the thing is, I was thinking about that this morning, and that's how life is. If you look at life, we can kind of break life down into four quarters. You know, when we're in our infancy, you know, we can kind of consider that the first quarter. You know, when we're in our teenage years, that's the second quarter. Then we enter into adulthood, and then before we know it, we're seniors, and we consider that the last quarter. But then we even can look at life in terms of halves, and I don't know why, but it's almost like once you turn 30, people automatically assume that you're in the second half of your life. But the difference between the game of basketball and the game of life is there's a clock. There's a visible clock. So you can prepare for the outcome. So you can look at the clock and say, a minute ago, we got this game. We won. Or there's 5 minutes ago, we can make a comeback. But in the game of life, there is no clock. So you never really know when you're down. And you never really know when you're up. And you never really know when it's the first half. And you never really know when it's the second half. And so it's that buzzer beater moment that everybody lives for. You know, everybody's practicing before, if you're into sports, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and you shoot it because there's a visible clock. But because we live without a clock, every day of our life has to be a buzzer beater moment. That means that everything we do, I think it's Colossians chapter 3:23, that if you're gonna do anything, do it with all of your heart. Do it with all of your heart and do it with all your effort. And so what I wanna say is that we really don't know how much time that we have in the game of life. We can't really look at the clock and say, oh, it's the first quarter, I got plenty of time, or you know what, I'm in the first half, I've got 30 more years. you never really know how much time is on your game clock. And so what that really means is, to be honest, you can be here today and gone tomorrow. And so if you really think about that, if we're really going to pursue our buzzer beater moment, that means that we can't afford to go a day without knowing who Christ is. We can't afford a moment without knowing who God is in our life. And so this invitation to discipleship is really for two groups of people. The first group of people is for people who say, you know what, I want to be in the game of life, but I just don't know the rules of life. I don't really know how to play. That means that I haven't given my life to Christ. So that means I really don't know what He expects of me. And so just to simplify that, that really means that I want to be saved. I want to give my life to Christ. That's the first group, okay? The second group is, I'm in the game. I know how to play a little bit, but I'm going through the motions. I'm in the game, but I'm not really giving my best effort. I'm just going through the motions. I'm just going back and forth to say that I'm playing, which really translates into I'm living just to say I'm living. So that first group is to young or adults who say, you know what, I don't have a relationship with Christ. And I can't afford to miss my buzzer beater moment. I can't afford to leave tonight and not know Him, because my life clock might expire and I might leave this earth not having a relationship with Him. That's the first group. And the second group is, I just really need to rededicate myself. I realize that God has put greater in me. I realize that He has more for my life. I realize that I'm gonna go through some storms, but I realize that greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. And so, if you're a young person, let me tell you this, because I'm a teacher, I know how it works. You almost have to get social permission to step out and be bold. That means you gotta look left to see who's going, and look right to see who's going. But if you know that you don't have a relationship with Christ, and you can't afford to take a chance that you may wake up tomorrow morning, if you know that you can't take that chance, I really want you to come forward. And if you're sitting next to somebody who you may feel that may have a relationship with Christ, just ask them if you're a little shy. Ask them if they'll walk down front with you. In fact, if you're sitting next to somebody, why don't you ask them, do you meet one of the criteria? Have you given your life to Christ? And would you like to rededicate your life to Christ? Because what I've learned in my own life is, you can be pretty good at a lot of things without Christ, but you don't qualify to be great without Christ. And so anything that you want to be great at, you have to be connected to Christ. That promise in 1 John 4:4, the greater is He that's in you. He basically lets us know that He's left a piece of greatness in you. But you don't have access to that great inheritance without first going through the Son of Jesus. And so, again, if you feel that you need a relationship with Christ, you know, I would just ask you to come down front. We have, any deacons here, any ministers, any intercessors. If you have a relationship and you just want to rededicate that walk with Christ, this is for you as well. And maybe you're just excited about your school year and you want to do great things. Maybe you want to do something you've never done before and you just want someone to touch and agree with you tonight before you leave. It's for you as well. So that means that every young person here, not only you're connected to Christ, but you're connected to your greatness and you walk in your greatness. Is that right? Is that right? Well, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise here. That's good. And honestly, if you are a little bit shy, like I was when I was your age, this isn't something that you have to do here. You know, you can this invitation you can accept anywhere. You know, when you get home, when you get with someone at your church, youth advisor, coach, whatever, you can give. There's no prerequisites about when and how you can give your life to Christ. The Bible only requires two requirements, and that is you have to speak it. You have to speak it, and you have to say it, and you have to mean it with all your heart. And if you do those two things, it doesn't matter where you are. So if you get somewhere and you feel like that you missed out on the opportunity, you really didn't miss out. So that opportunity is always there. So so let's give TJ a hand. Another hand. So this is the part where we just kind of make some general announcements. I have a few announcements I like to make. Eastern Star Senior Citizens will be sponsoring a trip and lunch to the Heritage Museum in Tillery, North Carolina on August the 22nd, 2016. They will be leaving the church at 10 a.m. We invited any senior citizen from Eastern Star and our youth to go with us. Please see Sister Delia Perkins, Sister Lucinda Shipp, Sister Valerie Kenny, Deacon William Joyner, if you would like to attend this trip, okay? Also, we'd like to announce, we announced last night, we announced again that this Saturday, on August the 6th, from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., Eastern Star, our Young Adults Advisory Committee, in conjunction with our youth ministry, will be hosting our back-to-school bash. It's going to be held on the corner of East and Oakland Street, so if you keep straight out Church Street, just keep straight, you'll run right into a field that's kind of in conjunction with Pertilla Middle School, which is that campus area. That's where it's going to be. So I think the first 100 youth that arrive will receive a book bag with school supplies. If you're not part of the first 100, there'll be food, games, fellowship. Just be a great time for you just to relax and fellowship and have a good time before school resumes. So that's this Saturday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. on August the 6th. Also, there was a young lady last night who wanted to make an announcement about there's a Heart Matters campaign that's beginning, focused on Nash and Edgecombe County. I think it's a nonprofit organization or some type of organization that's really focusing on high blood pressure and heart disorders amongst African Americans. The numbers are staggering in terms of heart attacks and high blood pressure amongst African American community. So her name is Ms. Marsha Sims. I have a flyer here if anybody's interested. I think there is some type of compensation, but it is like a 6-month commitment. So that's Project Grace. Are there any announcements from the floor at this time? Anymore need to make an announcement? Yes, sir.
Thank you. I greet you with the joy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'd like to say on August the 13th at Carver School, we're having a back to school bash also. And we're giving away 400 book bags along. It's hosted by the Pine Top Oast Body Community Center, taking with the Pine Tops and Havens of Pine Tops. And if they don't, when y'all give out the 100 bags, send them to Pine Top to the Carver School from 10 to 2 on August the 13th. And we will be giving away 400 book bags with all the supplies to go in the book bag. They'll have fun, they'll have rides for everyone, and food and all that good stuff too.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you. Any other announcements from the floor? Yes, Deacon Rich.
Brother Jesus, let me update everyone on the announcement you made about the young lady who came last night, Pastor Sterling McFarland from Grand Hope Christian Church in Quincy. And Eastern Star has partnered with Project Grace, which is a nonprofit organization, in the study of heart disease in African Americans. And on tomorrow, and that's what I want to point out, that on tomorrow, you can actually come here. If you see Sis Dickens, if you'll stand, you'll see Sis Dickens. She'll be available for you to contact her so that you can register to be a participant in this study. It's a year-long study, but you get $25 for coming and signing up and going through the question. And if you qualify, you get $25. Qualifications are you have to be at least 21 years of age, you have to live in Nashville, Edgecombe County, and you cannot be on a high blood pressure or a blood pressure medication. And it's a year-long study. You get $25 to sign up if you meet qualifications, and you get $20 every time you come. And it's a free program, and they're looking for as many African Americans to participate as possible. But again, we have someone here at our church tomorrow. If you'd like to come and see if you qualify, you can see Sis Dickens, and she'll put your name on the list. And that's what I want to clarify.
Okay. Thank you. Yes. Strong.
Also, on August 13th, the MA Race Center will be having a back-to-school bash. It starts from 12 to 4. We also will be giving out book bags and school supplies. That's August 13th.
Any other announcements from the floor? I'm just telling you what I see. So when we come back from spring break in April, everybody running out of paper and pencils and stuff. You guys hear all these back to school supplies. Even if you got to hit them all up, go ahead and get it. Borrow my stuff. But one more announcement. As you were coming in, if you notice out there in the vestibule area, there's a dream board. And so if you are a young person, we want everybody to make sure that you stop by. We want you to take an index card, write your name and your school on one side, and on the back, just tell us a little bit about your dreams, because what's going to happen is after Youth Revival is over, we're going to take those cards and we're going to be praying for you. Because one thing I have found is that people don't dream anymore. People have stopped dreaming. In fact, you know what? That's not just young people. If you're an adult and you still have dreams, I want you to fill out a card too. Because what I see from my perspective is we'll ride Kobe's dreams, but we don't realize that the same dream that happened for him can happen for us. And so we become dream riders instead of dreamers. And so what I want is, young people, you can dream again. And so we want you to write your dreams down, and we're not just going to pray for you one time. If it's up to me and if it's up, we're going to be praying for you all throughout the year. And so that's why we want your name, your school, and we want your dreams. Because we don't want the theme of this revival, you have a dream. Well, it's one thing to have a dream, and then it's another thing to actually chase it and believe that it can happen to you. And so please make sure you stop by again. That's for young people, middle age, it doesn't matter. If you still have dreams, and as long as you've got breath in your body, then you can seize those dreams. You can have those dreams. And so, again, we'd like to thank everybody for coming out tonight. TJ, again, you got in. Absolutely awesome, man. You did a great job. And I know tomorrow night is going to be extremely special as well. So I'm seeing a lot of your characteristics come out. You know, you preach like you used to play basketball. You know, he kind of starts out and then he goes at you and there's nothing you can do about it. So I'm glad that when he was playing, we stopped playing Rocky Mountain. Anyway, I'm going to ask you to come back, Minister Walker, and just close us out in your own special way.
Let us all stand. We're down to one more night. Pray everybody's excited. I'm excited. I'm not excited that it's the last night, but I am excited to see what God has in store for each and every last one of us. Far if y'all don't mind, y'all can do some of that ride out of the storm that you were planning earlier. If y'all enjoyed this choir. Ride it out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.